My dear students, a very warm welcome to all of you in today's session of anatomy. Our topic today is pleura, and I know every one of you have some preliminary knowledge about pleura. So without further ado, let's begin. We have got two lungs, which are the respiratory organs. Now each of the lung is invested by two serous membranes. The inner one is called the visceral pleura, and the outer one is called the parietal pleura. These two membranes are continuous with each other, and together, that means together, the visceral and parietal pleura form an enclosed serous sac, which is called the pleural sac. The space between the visceral and the parietal pleura is called the pleural cavity. Okay, this pleural cavity is filled with a very little amount, 5 to 10 ml of serous fluid, which is called the pleural fluid, which keeps the both of the pleura lubricated and help them move against each other without any friction or with very little friction. A little description of development of lung will make it easier to understand the relationship of the lung and the pleura. Now, during early embryonic life, each lateral compartment of the thoracic cavity is occupied by a closed serous sac, which is invaginated from the medial side by the lung, and as a result of this invagination, it is converted into a double-layered serous sac. The outer layer is called the parietal pleura, and the inner layer is called the visceral pleura. The visceral pleura is continuous with parietal pleura at the root of the lung. This parietal and visceral pleura are separated from each other by a slit-like potential space, which is called the pleural cavity. The pleural cavity is normally filled with a thin film of tissue fluid, which lubricates the adjoining surfaces of the pleura and allow them to move on each other without any friction. These two layers become continuous with each other by means of a cuff of pleura, which surround the root of the lung, consisting of the structures entering and leaving the lung through the hilum of the lung. Basically, the root of the lung refers to a collection of structure that either enter or exit the lung. Now, this collection of structure form a pedicle which connect the lung with the mediastinum. In this context, I must tell you that mediastinum is basically a mobile tissue partition located between the two lungs. In between the two lungs, there is a space, and that space is occupied by a number of structures, a number of organs and tissues, which make it a mobile partition between the two lungs. This partition is called the mediastinum. So mediastinum is connected to the lung by means of the lung root. Next, we will see the histology of the pleura. Now, we have told you that pleura, each of the pleura is a serous membrane. Now, this pleura is a monolayer of mesothelial cells. Basically, what is happening is that a layer of squamous epithelium is sitting upon matrix of collagen, elastic fiber, blood vessel and lymphatics. So basically, pleura is made up of a sheet, a monolayer of squamous epithelial cell, which sit on a basement membrane, and this basement membrane rest on a matrix of collagen, elastic fiber, blood vessel and lymphatics. So this allows the lung and chest to expand and contract, protected from the friction by the pleural fluid and properties of the mesothelial cells. Now, underneath these mesothelial cells, underneath the epithelium, lie the blood vessels and lymphatic. So, blood vessel and lymphatic just lie deep to the mesothelial layer. Now, I will talk about the thoracic cavity a little bit to understand the disposition of the pleura. The thoracic cavity is divided into three compartments: right lateral, left lateral and middle compartment. Each lateral compartment is occupied by a lung, which is enclosed in a serous sac called pleural sac. The middle compartment contains essentially all the thoracic structures except lungs, such as heart with pericardium, great blood vessels that leave or enter the heart, structures that traverse the thorax to enter the abdomen in passing from the neck to the abdomen or from abdomen to neck, such as esophagus, vagus nerve, phrenic nerve, and thoracic duct. The mass of tissue and organ that occupy the middle compartment, they form a mobile septum, which is called mediastinum, that completely separates the two pleural cavities. Now we can see the two lungs and intervening mobile tissue septum, which is called the mediastinum. Right? We can see the heart covered by pericardium along with the great blood vessel, namely the arch of aorta and the pulmonary trunk that is coming out of the, that is leaving the heart. Then we get to see the esophagus, trachea, descending thoracic aorta, and also in some diagram we get to see the thoracic duct as well. So all this structure form the mediastinum. Let's see more closely. The middle compartment in between the two lung here is depicted, and here we get to see all the midline structures like trachea, esophagus, then we get to see the vagus nerve going down. So all these structures, they are forming a mobile partition which is filled with tissue and connective tissue, and that is present in between the two lungs, and it form the mediastinum. Now we have told you that the pleura is divided into two types. The outer one is called the parietal pleura and the inner one is called the visceral pleura. Now the parietal pleura is thicker than the visceral pleura and lines the wall of the pulmonary cavity. For the purpose of description, it is customary to divide the parietal pleura according to the surface which it lines or the region which it covers. Thus, parietal pleura is divided into the following four parts: costal pleura, diaphragmatic pleura, mediastinal pleura, and cervical pleura. Now we will demonstrate the subdivision for the purpose of description. Costal pleura, on the lining the thoracic wall. Then the cervical pleura, covering the apex of the lung. Diaphragmatic pleura over here, covering the superior surface of diaphragm. And the other one is the mediastinal pleura. You can see over at the side of the mediastinal pleura that the mediastinal pleura is folded up to cover the structures that form the root of the lung. It is forming a pedicle, and that pedicle is continuous downwards as a bilayered fold that is called the pulmonary ligament. So basically, pulmonary ligament is a bilaminar fold of the mediastinal pleura that extend below the root of the lung, and it provide a dead space for the structure of the root of the lung, especially for the pulmonary veins. Next, about the costal pleura. Costal pleura lines the inner surface of the thoracic wall, which consists of ribs, costal cartilages, and intercostal spaces. To the thoracic wall, the costal pleura is loosely attached by a thin layer of loose areolar tissue, which is called the endothoracic fascia. In living beings, endothoracic fascia is easily separable from the thoracic wall. Underneath the costal pleura lie the costal surface of the lung covered by visceral pleura. Next is the diaphragmatic pleura. Diaphragmatic pleura covers the superior surface of the diaphragm, and in quiet respiration, the costal and diaphragmatic pleura are in opposition to each other below the inferior border of the lung. mediastinal pleura, it lines the corresponding surface of the mediastinum and it forms the lateral boundary of the mediastinum. It is reflected as a cuff over the root of the lung and becomes continuous with the visceral pleura. Next is the pulmonary ligament. The mediastinal pleura surrounding the root of the lung, much like the cuff or sleeve of a jacket around the wrist. It extends down as a fold called pulmonary ligament. The pulmonary ligament extends from the root of the lung as far as the diaphragm between the lungs and the mediastinum. The fold is filled with loose areolar tissue and a few lymphatics. What are the functions of pulmonary ligament? Pulmonary ligament provides a dead space into which the pulmonary veins can expand during increased venous return as during exercise. It also helps with the descent of the root of the lung along with the descent of the diaphragm during inspiration. As a result, the apex of the lungs comes down from the tough suprapleural membrane, leaving an empty space below the membrane. Now the apex of the lung can expand in this empty space. The root of the lung, what is the root of the lung? The root of the lung is a short, broad pedicle connecting the medial surface of the lung with the mediastinum. Here I must mention that each of the lung has got a costal surface underneath the costal pleura, a medial surface underneath the mediastinal pleura, an apex and a base. Apex lie underneath the cervical pleura and base under the diaphragmatic pleura. Now root of the lung is a short broad pedicle which connect the medial surface of the lung with the mediastinum. It consists of structures entering and leaving the lung at the hilum. The hilum is the area on the mediastinal surface of the lung through which the structures enter or leave the lung. The root of lung is surrounded by a tubular sheath derived from the mediastinal pleura. What are the components of the root of the lung? The root of the lung consists of the following structures. Number one, principal bronchus in the left lung and aparterial and hyperterial bronchi in the right lung. Number two, pulmonary artery. Number three, pulmonary veins, two in number. Number four, bronchial arteries, one on right side and two on the left side. Number five, bronchial veins. Number six, lymphatics of the lung. Number seven, anterior and posterior pulmonary plexus of the nerves. Here in this diagram, we can see the principal bronchus, pulmonary artery, pulmonary veins. The bronchial arteries and veins, along with the lymphatics and pulmonary plexus, has not been depicted in the diagram. Now, what are the relation of the root of the lung? Anterior to the root of the lung lie the phrenic nerve, anterior pulmonary plexus and superior vena cava onto the right side. Posterior to the root of the lung lie the vagus nerve, posterior pulmonary plexus and descending thoracic aorta on the left side. Superior to it is the arch of Ajaigo's vein and arch of aorta. And inferior to the root of the lung is the pulmonary ligament. Hilar shadow in chest radiograph. In X-ray chest PA view, the root of each lung cast a radiopaque shadow. It is called the hilar shadow in the medial one-third of the lung field. This shadow is in fact cast by pulmonary vessels when seen end on. The enlargements of bronchopulmonary lymph nodes or hilar lymph nodes increase the density of the shadows. Now, what about the arrangement of the structure at the root of the lung? The arrangement of the structure at the root of the lung is as follows. Now, from before backwards, it is more or less similar in both the sides. It is in the sequence of pulmonary vein, then pulmonary artery and the bronchus, VAB, vein artery bronchus. Okay. But from above downwards, it differs in two sides. In case of right side, above downwards, the structures are aparterial bronchus, pulmonary artery, hypertrochial bronchus, and inferior pulmonary vein. Here I must tell you that in case of the right lung, the principal bronchi before entering into the lung substance divide into superior, which is called the aparterial bronchus, and inferior division, which is called the hypertrochial bronchus. In the left side, we get to see the pulmonary artery above, followed by the left principal bronchus and inferior pulmonary vein. The difference in the arrangement of the structure from above downward of the two sides is because the right principal bronchus before entering the lung at hilum divides into two lobar bronchi. The upper lobar bronchi passes above the pulmonary artery, which is called the aparterial bronchus, and lower lobar bronchus passes below the pulmonary artery, which is called the hypertrochial bronchus. Next is the cervical pleura. Cervical pleura is actually the dome of parietal pleura, which extend into the root of the neck about 1 inch or 2.5 centimeter above the medial end of clavicle and 2 inches above the first costal cartilage. It is called cupola and cover the apex of the lung. Therefore, utmost caution needs to be taken while penetrating this area with the anesthetic needle. It is covered by the suprapleural membrane. Now we can see the tracing of the cervical pleura, which forms a dome of the parietal pleura. The cervical pleura is represented by a curved line. Okay. One end of this curved line lie at the sternoclavicular joint, and the other end at the junction between the medial one third and middle one third of the clavicle. And the summit of this curved line lie about 2.5 centimeter above the medial third of clavicle. Now, underneath the cervical pleura lie the apex of the lung. The apex having a same kind of outline like the cervical pleura. It is a rounded, blunt, superior end of the lung. It extends into the root of the neck about 3 cm superior to the anterior end of the first rib and 2.5 cm above the medial one third of the clavicle. It is covered by the cervical pleura and the suprapleural membrane. Relation: anteriorly the subclavian artery, internal thoracic artery, and the scalenus anterior muscle, and posteriorly the neck of first rib and structures in front of it. I mean the ventral ramus of first thoracic nerve, first posterior intercostal artery, first posterior intercostal vein, and the sympathetic chain. Relation of the cervical pleura is much like the relation of the apex of the lung. Anteriorly lie the subclavian artery and the scalenus anterior muscle, which is present between the subclavian vein in front and the subclavian artery behind. Posteriorly, it is the neck of the first rib and the structure passing in front of it, like the sympathetic trunk, first posterior intercostal vein, superior intercostal artery, and the T1 spinal nerve. Laterally lies the scalenus medius muscle, and medially is present the great vessels of the neck. So that is the relation of the cervical pleura. There is a term called Pankow syndrome, which occurs due to involvement of the structures related to the posterior aspect of the apex of lung by the cancer of the lung apex. The clinical features in Pankow syndrome occurs as a result of the involvement of the ventral ramus of T1 and also the involvement of sympathetic chain. So what occurs? Due to the involvement of ventral ramus of T1, there is pain along the medial side of the forearm and hand, and wasting of the small muscles of the hand due to involvement of the ventral ramus of T1. Due to involvement of the sympathetic chain, there is Horner's syndrome. Along with, there is the erosion of the first rib. Cancer of the apex of the lung may spread to involve neighboring structures such as subclavian or brachiocephalic vein, subclavian artery, phrenic nerve, causing following signs and symptoms. There will be venous engorgement and edema of the neck, face and arm due to involvement of the subclavian and the brachiocephalic veins. There may be diminished brachial or radial pulse due to compression on the subclavian artery and paralysis of the heavy diaphragm due to infiltration of the phrenic nerve. Now we will discuss a bit about the suprapleural membrane that covers the cervical pleura. Suprapleural membrane overlies the cervical pleura, reinforces it and prevents it from external trauma. It is called the diaphragm of the superior thoracic aperture. If you look at the thoracic cavity, the suprapleural membrane is present at the inlet of the thoracic cavity, covering it partially, and the outlet is covered by the diaphragm. Now, diaphragm of superior thoracic aperture, which is also the other name of the suprapleural membrane, is also known as Simpson's fossa. So, Simpson's fossa basically encloses the thoracic inlet on either side. It is a dense fossal sheet and it is tent-shaped. What are the attachments? The apex of Simpson's fossa is attached to the tip of the transverse process of the C7 vertebra and its base is attached to the inner border of the first rib and its costal cartilage. Its superior surface is related to the subclavian vessels and inferior surface is related to the cervical pleura covering the apex of the lung. Functions of Simpson's fossa. Number 1, Simpson's fossa protect the underlying cervical pleura beneath which lie the apex of the lung. Number 2, it raises the intrathoracic pressure during respiration. As a result, the root of the neck is not puffed up and down during respiration. So during respiration, only diaphragm descends, not the suprapleural membrane. There is no change of position of the suprapleural membrane. Morphologically, Simpson's fossa represents a spread out degenerated tendon of scalenus minimus muscle. Now the cervical pleura, I have already told you, it is marked by a curved line with convexity directed upwards, which is drawn from the sternoclavicular joint to the junction of medial third and middle third of the clavicle. The summit of the dome of cervical pleura lies 2.5 cm above the medial one third of the clavicle, and apex of the lung has a similar outline as that of the cervical pleura and it is covered by cervical pleura. Now we'll discuss about the lines of pleural reflection. Lines of pleural reflection are those areas where one type of parietal pleura changes into another type of parietal pleura. It kind of folds back into along these lines of reflection to cover the other surface of the lung. First, we discuss about the anterior or costomediastinal line of pleural reflection. It differs on two sides. On the right side, it extends downward and medially from the right sternoclavicular joint to the midpoint of the sternal angle and then descends vertically up to the midpoint of the zephysternal joint. Anterior or costomediastinal line of pleural reflection on the left side extend downward and medially from the left sternoclavicular joint to the midpoint of the sternal angle and then descends vertically only up to the level of the fourth costal cartilage. It then arches outwards to reach the sternal margin of sternum and runs downward a short distance lateral to this margin to reach the sixth costal cartilage, about 3 cm from the midline, leaving a part of pericardium directly in contact with the anterior chest wall, which is called the bare area of the heart. Inferior or costodiaphragmatic line of pleural reflection. On the right side, the line of reflection starts from the zephysternal joint or behind the xiphoid process and crosses the 8th rib in the midclavicular line, 10th rib in the mid-axillary line and 12th rib at the lateral border of the erector spiny muscle, 2 cm lateral to the spine of T12 vertebra. On the left side, the line of reflection starts at the level of 6th costal cartilage, about 2 cm lateral to the midline. Thereafter, it follows the same course as on the right side. Posterior or costovertebral line of pleural reflection. It ascends from the end of the inferior line 2 cm lateral to the T12 spine along the vertebral column to the point 2 cm lateral to the spine of C7 vertebra. The costal pleura becomes mediastinal pleura along this line. Now we discuss about the recesses of pleura. Normally, the space between the parietal and the visceral pleura is only a potential space and is filled with thin film of serous fluid. However, in areas of pleural reflection onto the diaphragm and mediastinum, the space between parietal and visceral pleura is greatly expanded. These expanded regions of pleural cavity are called pleural recesses. They are essential for lung expansion during deep inspiration. Thus, pleural recesses serve as reserve spaces of pleural cavity for the lungs to expand during deep inspiration. These recesses are as follows. Number 1, the costodiaphragmatic recess, right and left. And number 2, costomediastinal recess, right and left. The costodiaphragmatic recess, it is located inferiorly between the costal and diaphragmatic pleura. Vertically, it measures about 5 cm and lie opposite the 8th to 10th ribs along the mid-axillary line. The costodiaphragmatic recesses are the most dependent parts of the pleural cavities, hence the fluid of pleural effusion first collect at these sites. Pleural effusion. Normally, the pleural cavity contains only 5 to 10 ml of clear fluid, which lubricates the pleural surfaces to allow their smooth movements without friction. The excessive accumulation of fluid in the pleural cavity is called pleural effusion. It usually occurs due to inflammation of pleura. The pleural effusion leads to decreased expansion of the lungs on the side of effusion. Clinically, it can be detected with decreased breath sound and dullness of percussion on the site of effusion. Various fluid can accumulate in the pleural space, such as serous fluid, which is known as hydrothorax, blood, which is known as hemothorax, pus, which is known as pyothorax, or more commonly as pleural empyema, chyle, that is known as chylothorax, or very rarely urine as well, which is known as urinothorax. When unspecified, the term pleural effusion normally refers to hydrothorax. A pleural effusion may be coupled with pneumothorax, that is the accumulation of air in the pleural space, and this leads to a condition which is called hydropneumothorax. Now, there are conditions which are associated with transudative pleural effusion include congestive heart failure, liver cirrhosis, severe hypoalbuminemia, and nephrotic syndrome. Here, I must specify two types of pleural effusion. One is the transudative pleural effusion, where there is an increased pressure buildup in the blood vessels lining the pleura, and as a result of it, liquid of the blood, that is the plasma portion of the blood, is actually going out of the blood vessel and accumulate into the pleural cavity. And there is another kind of pleural effusion, that is the exudative kind, where there is increased leakiness of the blood vessels lining the pleura, and the fluid portion of the blood leaks through this increased leakiness and give rise to pleural effusion. So, transudative pleural effusion results from congestive heart failure, liver cirrhosis, severe hypoalbuminemia, and nephrotic syndrome. Conditions which are associated with exudative pleural effusion include inflammation, malignancy, either lung cancer or metastasis to the pleura from elsewhere, or infection like tuberculosis, bacterial pneumonia, or trauma. Clinical importance. A pleural effusion is usually diagnosed on the basis of medical history and physical exam and confirmed by chest x-ray. Once accumulated fluid is more than 300 ml, there are usually detectable clinical signs like decreased movement of the chest on the affected site, dullness to percussion over the fluid. There will be diminished breath sound on the affected side and decreased vocal resonance. Radiological appearance of pleural effusion. When a small quantity of fluid collects in the costodiaphragmatic recess, the costodiaphragmatic angle is obliterated. There is widening of the angle. It is seen as a radio-opaque shadow with a fluid line in X-ray chest. This may be the first indication of pleural effusion. Therefore, recesses of the pleura are examined routinely in the chest radiographs. The costodiaphragmatic recess can be entered through the 9th and 10th intercostal spaces without penetrating the lung in patient because it lies opposite 8th to 10th ribs. Next, we discuss about the costomediastinal recess. The costomediastinal recess is located anteriorly between the costal and mediastinal pleura and lies between the sternum and the costal cartilage. The right costomediastinal recess is possibly occupied by the anterior margin of the right lung even during quiet breathing. Now, coming on to the left costomediastinal recess, it is larger than the right due to the presence of cardiac notch in the left lung. Its location can be confirmed clinically by percussion or tapping of the chest wall. As one moves during tapping from the area of underlying lung tissue to the area of the left costomediastinal recess unoccupied by lung tissue, a change in tone from resonant to dull is noticed. This is called the area of superficial cardiac dullness. Clinical correlation. Sites of extension of pleura beyond the thoracic cage. There are 5 sites where pleura extends beyond the thoracic cage. Number 1, on either side of the root of the neck. Number 2, in the right ziphisternal angle. And number 3, on either side in the costovertebral angle. The pleura can be punctured inadvertently at these sites during surgical procedures. Nerve supply of the pleura. The parietal pleura develops from somatopleuric layer of the lateral plate mesoderm, hence it is supplied by the somatic nerves and sensitive to pain. Costal and peripheral part of the diaphragmatic pleura is supplied by the intercostal nerves. Mediastinal and central part of the diaphragmatic pleura is supplied by the phrenic nerve. The visceral pleura develops from splanchnopleuric layer of lateral plate mesoderm, hence it is supplied by the autonomic nerves T2 to T5 and is insensitive to pain. Clinical correlation, referred pain of pleura. The pain from central diaphragmatic pleura and mediastinal pleura is referred to the neck or the shoulder through the phrenic nerve, C3, C4 and C5. Because keen at this site of shoulder has also the same segmental supply via the supraclavicular nerve having the same root value as the splenic nerve, C3, C4 and C5. Next, we discuss about the pleurisy or pleuritis. Pleurisy or pleuritis is the inflammation of the pleura. Clinically, it presents as pain, which is aggravated by respiratory movements and radiates to the thoracic and abdominal walls. It is commonly caused by pulmonary TB. The pleural surface becomes thickened and rough due to accumulation of inflammatory exudate, and due to roughening of the pleural surface, friction occurs between the two layers of pleura during respiratory movements. Thus, pleural rub can be heard with stethoscope on the surface of the chest wall during inspiration and expiration. The collection of serous fluid, air, blood and pus in the pleural cavity is termed hydrothorax, pneumothorax, hemothorax and pyothorax or empyema respectively. What causes pleurisy? Pleurisy can be caused by one of the following conditions. Number 1 is the infection. Bacterial, including those which cause the tuberculosis, fungi, parasites or viruses. Number 2, inhaled chemicals or toxic substances, exposure to some cleaning agents like ammonia. Number 3, collagen vascular disease like lupus, rheumatoid arthritis. And number 4, cancers, for example, the spread of lung cancer or breast cancer to the pleura. How the pleurisy is treated? At first, the underlying cause must be treated. And number two, in case of pleural effusion that result from cancer, the fluid often reaccumulates. In this setting, a procedure called pleurodesis is used. The procedure entails instilling an irritant such as bleomycin, tetracycline or talc powder inside the space between the pleural layer in order to create an inflammation. This inflammation in turn will adhere or tack or seal the two layers of the pleura together as scarring develops. This procedure thereby obliterates the space between the pleura and prevents the reaccumulation of fluid. Blood supply and lymphatic drainage of pleura. The parietal pleura is a part and parcel of the thoracic wall. Its blood supply and lymphatic drainage are therefore the same as that of the body wall. It is thus supplied by the intercostal, internal thoracic and musculophrenic arteries. And the veins drain mostly into the azygos and internal thoracic vein. Let's see the vein. There is the azygos and internal thoracic vein. Regarding the lymphatics, they drain into the intercostal, internal mammary, posterior mediastinal and diaphragmatic nodes. So that is about the parietal pleura. What about the visceral or pulmonary pleura? The visceral pleura is supplied by the bronchial arteries, which is the same as the lung, and it is drained by the drains, which also drain the lung, that is the bronchial veins. And visceral pleura lymphatic drainage is also the same as the lung, and it is drained by the bronchopulmonary lymph nodes. We often hear a term, thoracocentesis of pleural tube. That is a very important topic. It is a procedure by which the excess fluid can be aspirated from the pleural cavity. It is performed with the patient in sitting position. Usually the needle is inserted into the 8th intercostal space in the mid-axillary line. The needle is inserted into the lower part of intercostal space along the upper border of the rib to avoid injury to the intercostal lumps and vessels which are present along the lower border of the ribs. The needle passes in successively through the skin, superficial fascia, serratus anterior, intercostal muscles, endothoracic fascia and parietal pleura to reach the pleural cavity. Now this procedure is used to determine the etiology of pleural fluid, that is called diagnostic thoracocentesis, or to relieve dyspnea caused by pleural fluid accumulation, which is called therapeutic thoracocentesis. Diagnostic thoracocentesis entails determination of pleural effusion etiology, like whether it is transudative due to CHF or whether it is exudative due to inflammation or malignancy. It usually requires removal of 50 to 100 ml of pleural fluid for laboratory studies. Potential complication of pleural tap is pain, bleeding and pneumothorax, that is the entry of air into the pleural cavity during the procedure. The patient is positioned on the edge of the bed, leaning forward with their arms resting on a bedside table. If the patient is unable to sit up, the lateral recumbent or supine position may be used. The patient may receive a sedative prior to the procedure to help the patient relax. He is asked to remove any clothing, jewelry or any other object that may interfere with the procedure, and he is also asked not to cough. The area around the puncture site may be shaved. Vital signs like pulse, BP, respiration, temperature and oxygen level are to be monitored periodically before the procedure. There is a term called pneumothorax, which is the accumulation of air into the pleural cavity. There is spontaneous or closed pneumothorax. As the name suggests, in spontaneous pneumothorax, air enters into the pleural cavity suddenly by the rupture of air-filled cavities within the lung tissues. And this kind of pneumothorax is basically closed pneumothorax, that means the accumulated air into the pleural cavity has no communication with the outside atmosphere. Whereas in open pneumothorax, this condition occurs due to stab wound of the thoracic wall, which pierces the pleura, or any other kind of injury, leading to the communication of air of the pleural cavity with the outside. Consequently, each time when the patient inspires, the air is sucked into the pleural cavity, and this kind of pneumothorax is called the open pneumothorax. Now, as I have already told you about the open pneumothorax, there is another condition. It is called tension pneumothorax. Now, sometimes what happens is that during inspiration, the air can enter through the wound, but it cannot exit through it during expiration. So in this circumstance, a valve is formed which only lets in air into the lungs, into the pleural cavity during inspiration, but does not let out air during expiration. So what will happen in this circumstance? Air pressure build up continuously in the pleural cavity, and it pushes the mediastinum to the opposite side. That is, it is pushing the mediastinum to the healthy side. This kind of pneumothorax is called the tension pneumothorax. Ultimately, tension pneumothorax will lead to collapse of the lung on the affected side and compression of the lung on the healthy side. Next, we discuss about the comparison between the visceral and parietal pleura. The visceral pleura development from the splanchnopleuric layer of lateral plate mesoderm, parietal pleura from the somatopleuric layer of lateral plate mesoderm. Position, it lines surface of the lung, including the fissures. Parietal pleura, it lines thoracic wall, mediastinum and diaphragm. Visceral pleura nerve supply, sympathetic and parasympathetic. Sympathetic nerves from the T2 to T5 and parasympathetic from the vagus. Whereas in case of parietal pleura, the nerve supply from the thoracic nerves like intercostal nerve and phrenic nerve. Sensitivity, as visceral pleura is supplied by the autonomic nerves, it is insensitive to pain. But in contrary, parietal pleura, which is supplied by somatic nerve, is sensitive to pain and it may be referred. Blood supply, visceral pleura by the bronchial vessel, same as that of the lung. Parietal pleura by the intercostal, pericardiocophrenic, musculophrenic, internal thoracic vessels. Lymphatic drainage, in case of visceral pleura, to the bronchopulmonary and tracheobronchial lymph nodes, and in case of parietal pleura, intercostal mediastinal lymph nodes. These have all been discussed earlier. That's all I had to say regarding pleura. Thank you everyone. Now go through the book and you will understand everything.